This is Thriller Forever, a video series chronicling every detail in the construction, release, and lasting impact of Michael Jackson's musical juggernaut. He expressed how upset he was about his perceived underperformance of Off the Wall. Michael vowed it can never happen again. With his next record, Jackson wanted to continue to push his creative capabilities. Producer Quincy Jones walked into Westlake Studios in Los Angeles and said, quote, "Okay guys, we're here to save the recorded music industry." Additionally, creative tensions started to reveal themselves between the two.
"He'll make you do a thing until it's perfect.
Over and over again?
Yes.
Be difficult to work with?"
The public's first hint of a new era of Michael Jackson came with the release of its lead single, a playful track he wrote and sang with ex-Beatle Paul McCartney, "The Girl Is Mine." The singer's first credited collaboration came about after Jackson and Quincy Jones visited McCartney at his ranch in Tucson, Arizona. Spending a couple of days rehearsing and indulging in the musician's shared obsession with cartoons. Quote, "When I approached Paul," Jackson wrote in his 1988 autobiography, Moonwalk, "I wanted to repay the favor he had done me in contributing Girlfriend to Off the Wall." The two soon began collaborating musically, a partnership that continued even when the Jacksons went on tour, with the ex-Beatle tagging along, songwriting with Michael whenever he was not on stage. During this time, the duo recorded Say, Say, Say and The Man for McCartney's upcoming fifth solo album, Pipes of Peace. However, it was now Michael's turn to write a song for them for his next LP. Producer Quincy Jones had initially told Jackson to write a song about two men fighting over a girl. Inspired, Jackson awoke during the night and sang the song into a tape recorder. He later said, quote, "I sang exactly what I heard in my head, starting with the melody and the keyboard and the strings and everything. So I just orally put it all on tape." Jones listened and then asked Jackson to add a rap verse of the two friends talking it out. Quote, "We're fighting over this girl in the song," Jackson said, "and it came out beautifully." The Superstar Duet was the first track recorded for Michael's new album at Westlake Studios, Los Angeles, from April 14th to the 16th, 1982. The session became a spectacle in itself, attracting press attention even before a single release date had been announced. Toto guitarist Steve Lukather, who had gotten a call from Jackson himself to play on several songs, vividly recalls, quote, "The McCartney duet was really insane," he said. "You can imagine what kind of a zoo it was, with Michael and Quincy and McCartney and all the people and the staff and the security. We never even got into the control room. Beatles producer George Martin and Beatles engineer Jeff Emmerich were there, Dick Clark. It was so intense." Despite the chaos and the distractions while recording, engineer Bruce Swedeen only had fond memories of the session. Quote, "Paul was such a gentleman. He came to the studio prepared. Linda McCartney was with him and we had a fabulous time." Michael Jackson even said that the recording of The Girl Is Mine was one of his most enjoyable moments in the studio. Reminiscing, quote, "Of all of my recordings as a solo artist, my favorite is probably The Girl Is Mine, because working with Paul McCartney was pretty exciting and we just literally had fun. It was like lots of kibitzing and playing and throwing stuff at each other and making jokes. We actually recorded the instrumental track and the vocals pretty much live at the same time."
And Michael and I were both up for working together and it was very professionally handled, you know, so that all it really needed was for us to get out there and perform and have a good time. But with Michael, it's not really work. It's just, it's more like play, you know. It's just like when you start up in the business or with a group and so they say, well, we play together. It's the word you use with music, isn't it? He plays. But what does he do for a living? He plays. And in this instance, that's all it was, really. We were just playing around.
After, Michael Jackson was positive they'd recorded a surefire hit, a signature tune for both of them that embodied McCartney's melody and his distinctive groove. Dick Clark commenting, quote, "Even during rehearsals of the tune, you knew it was going to be a hit. I could tell from the level of excitement in the place, the creative partnership was bound to be magic. And you know what? That's exactly what Michael Jackson says entertainment is. Magic." McCartney, however, expressed some trepidation about the song's bubblegum feel. He was especially concerned about the cloying use of the word doggone. quote, "You could say it's shallow," he admitted. When I checked it out with Michael, he explained that he wasn't going for depth. He was going for rhythm. He was going for feel. Released on October 18, 1982, a month before the album, and while the team was still recording, Bruce Swedeen recalls, quote, "Quincy would come in every morning and put on a couple of local radio stations, and they were all playing The Girl Is Mine. So that would make you very serious about your work very quickly." The single's cover photograph was taken by McCartney's wife, Linda, and while the sweet enough middle-of-the-road song was charming, one thing was certain. This wasn't the Don't Stop Till You Get Enough Part 2 many were expecting. But for Michael, the breezy radio-friendly tune was the obvious first single, especially after McCartney achieved a hit duet with Stevie Wonder, Ebony and Ivory, earlier that year. Later, writing that, quote, "We really didn't have much choice. When you have two strong names like that together on a song, it has to come out first or it gets played to death and overexposed. We had to get it out of the way." However, radio listeners were overall not that impressed by The Girl Is Mine and felt that Jackson and Jones had diluted their talents to accommodate to a white pop audience. Without anything else to go by, many feared Jackson's upcoming LP would also be a disappointment if the singer's overarching ambition was to achieve widespread commerciality. However, Jackson knew from experience with racially segregated radio airplay practices, releasing his McCartney collab first would give his subsequent releases a better chance of crossing over into the mainstream. Song Facts explaining, quote, "It was released first because it was guaranteed airplay thanks to McCartney's contribution. The song was a very safe choice as the first single, since it was very conventional and easy to understand. Jackson was afraid that if he released an edgy song first, people wouldn't give the album a chance." Jackson's instincts would ultimately be proven correct, as the mainstream track that essentially chronicles an interracial love triangle would go on to sell 1.3 million copies. The Girl Is Mine kicking off a string of chart success for Jackson, making it to number 2 on Billboard and all the way to number 1 on the R&B singles chart, the first time a Beatle topped the R&B list. Soon after, Michael Jackson's new album, Thriller, quietly slipped into the charts at number 11 on December 25, 1982. When compared to its lead single, the listeners were stunned by what they were confronted with as the album's opening track, instantly silencing those who believed Jackson may have lost his edge. Three ricocheting drumbeats kick off the frenetic opener. Appropriately titled Wanna Be Startin Somethin, its driving beat and hypnotic bass made it the closest thing on Thriller to Michael's previous output. Which is no surprise because the singer reportedly started working on the track while recording Off the Wall, which may be one reason it was chosen as the album opener. There simply wasn't a genre for a song like this in 1982. It wasn't disco. It wasn't funk. It wasn't R&B. It wasn't new wave. It was something new. A song so wild and energetic, it nearly bursts at the seams. Michael Jackson is in high-energy mode, nimbly and clearly enunciating the onrushing lyrics that varies from astonishment to righteous frustration. Jackson introduces a new tone that would soon become his signature, an edge of fear and paranoia. Unlike previous releases that centered on innocent crushes and dancing all night long, he, for the first time, depicts something darker and more insidious. A world hungry for idle gossip that feasts on rumor and innuendo. While even sparing a verse to square off with teen pregnancy, Jackson's vocals are biting, intense, and even taunting as he teases, "You're a vegetable, they eat off of you." Originally written for his sister LaToya about her troubled relationship with her sisters-in-law, Michael ended up recording the song himself. Bruce Swedeen recalling, quote, "That track is about Michael's brother's wives and how they were always creating trouble. That was his inspiration." The song was originally composed in 1978, but was later re-recorded in the fall of 1982 and was one of the four tracks that Jackson received writing credits for. Wanna Be Startin' Somethin' climaxes in an African-inspired chant, often misidentified as Swahili, but is actually based on Douala. giving the song an international flavor and reassuring listeners that Jackson hadn't lost his funk or forgotten his roots in black music. Journalist Nelson George writing that when the Jackson 5 traveled to Senegal in 1973, the experience had a profound effect on a teenage Michael Jackson. George quotes Jackson as saying, quote, "I don't want the blacks to ever forget that this is where we come from and where our music comes from. I want us to remember." A slight variation on Cameroonian saxophonist Manu Dibango's 1972 proto-disco hit, Sol Makossa. Quote, "Michael heard that and he liked it," recalled Quincy Jones. "I said, Michael, that's Manu Dibango's record. And he said, but I need it." This was the sound of a new pop renaissance. It had no borders. It was a sonic carnival, perfectly capturing the diversity, fusion, and velocity of a new era.
Well, I know that Michael would have a little, it wasn't a dictaphone, a little cassette. He'd be like, and you know, he would, I think, work out some things with that little move, you know. He was something else. He was able to create what he needed.
When released as a single, reviews for the track were positive. Christopher Connolly, writing for Rolling Stone, describing Wanna Be Startin' Somethin' as being, quote, "Thriller's most combative track." Connolly noting that in the hyperactive tune, Jackson's, quote, "emotions are so raw that the song nearly goes out of control." Cashbox called the song a smash, specifically praising the, quote, "danceable groove, superb arrangement, and strange but ultimately uplifting lyrics." Stephen Thomas Erlewine, a writer for AllMusic, described the song as, quote, "the freshest funk on the album." Ultimately, Wanna Be Startin' Somethin' was well received by listeners and charted around the world, receiving an award nomination for Best R&B Song at the 1984 Grammy Awards.